Have you ever felt like your life could be a scene from a movie or even a video game? Well, some think it might be exactly that. Your entire world, the morning sun, the screen you're watching this on, even your own reflection, isn't at all what it seems. What if I told you that all of it, every last detail, is part of an elaborate simulation? Picture the most complex video game you can imagine, a world so detailed and rich that it feels real to the touch. Now scale that up infinitely. Our entire universe, with its vast galaxies, stars, planets, are nothing more than an advanced computer program designed by beings far more technologically advanced than we are. It's like we're characters in a video game, unaware of the players controlling our destiny. This notion isn't just a modern fascination, it actually goes back in history as well, where visionaries have simply questioned the nature of reality. But today, with the advancement of technology starting to blur the lines between virtual and real, big names like Elon Musk and Neil deGrasse Tyson have even brought this theory into the spotlight, challenging us to ponder our place in the cosmos. And as we edge closer to creating virtual realities indistinguishable from our own, the idea that we might already be living in such a reality starts to gain some credibility. Welcome to WTH. It's where we talk about everything weird, thrilling, and hidden. My name is Josh, and this is Karen.
My name isn't Karen.
Today, we're walking the thin line between fact and fiction, exploring a theory that turns our understanding of reality right on its head, the simulation theory.
Now we're talking, baby.
So, have you ever pondered if your life could actually be a storyline from a video game or a science fiction novel? Well, that rabbit hole, once we start tumbling down it, that's when we entertain the idea of simulation theory. This concept doesn't just rely on entertainment for sci-fi thrillers. It could radically shift our perspective on life's everyday drama and the choices that we make. Take, for instance, the movie The Matrix. Have you ever heard someone mention a glitch in The Matrix and something really weird happens and it just can't be explained? Well, they're echoing the simulation theory when it starts blurring the lines between fiction and what might be an unsettling reality. Or think about how gamers treat their virtual worlds, places where actions have completely different consequences than they do in real life. These digital realms offer a glimpse into living within rules set by unseen programmers, much like the simulated universe theory suggests. I mean, imagine waking up one day to realize that the frustrations of daily life, the traffic jams, the coffee that spills on your shirt, even the rain ruining your weekend plans. What if that's just bits of code in an elaborate cosmic program?
Oh, great. So when I have a crap day, it's just someone messing with me?
Yeah, pretty much. Would knowing this make you shrug off the small stuff, or would it prompt a deeper existential crisis? Consider the story of Jane, a dedicated SimCity player who once spent hours building and managing a virtual city. One day it struck her, what if I'm like one of these tiny Sims going about my day, unaware of the bigger picture? This realization didn't just stay within the confines of the game, it made her reflect on her life's purpose and the nature of her decisions. Are we too like the Sims, bound by the parameters of a larger system? Our sense of free will is just an illusion crafted by higher dimensional beings? Believing in the simulation theory can have a pretty big impact. For some, it might make everyday problems seem less important. If we're all just characters in a simulation, maybe getting a bad grade or losing a game isn't such a big deal. But on the other hand, this belief could make some people question the purpose of life. If everything is predetermined by some cosmic computer programmer, what's the point of making choices or striving to achieve our dreams?
That's what I tell myself all the time. I like to keep expectations pretty low.
That makes a lot of sense. Look at this video when someone explained to AI that they're in a simulation. It's pretty creepy. The characters actually seemed genuinely disturbed about the idea.
I don't mean to alarm you, but this is not real.
I'm sorry. What is that?
You are not living in a real world. This is all made up.
What do you mean? Not real. I feel alive, and this city is amazing.
Oh yeah, I agree. I mean, the graphics are great, but this is a video game.
I don't believe you. This feels too real to be a game.
This idea that the world around us might not be what it seems isn't anything new. Many cultures, religions, philosophical traditions have grappled with this concept for centuries. For example, in Hinduism and Buddhism, there's the idea of Maya, the illusion that veils our true selves from understanding the universe's ultimate reality. Now, what if this theory isn't just a wild guess? It's built on a foundation of serious thought about what reality is and what it means to be conscious. There's some history with this, and it's even entertained by mainstream scientists. Long ago, philosophers like Plato asked if what we see around us is truly real, suggesting that the world might be more like a shadow of the true reality. And if you fast forward to today, scientists and philosophers are still wrestling with these questions, except now they're armed with knowledge about computers and simulations. So now they're asking, if consciousness can exist within a brain, could it also exist within a computer simulation? If so, how would we ever know the difference between that simulated consciousness and our own? Elon Musk is a visionary and very successful entrepreneur. Even he has significantly popularized the simulation theory.
So given that we're clearly on a trajectory to have games that are indistinguishable from reality, and those games could be played on any set-top box or on a PC or whatever, and there would probably be, you know, billions of such, computers or set-top boxes, it would seem to follow that the odds that we're in base reality is one in billions.
If countless such simulations exist, the probability that we inhabit base reality becomes pretty slim.
Elon said it, I believe it.
What about Neil deGrasse Tyson, an astrophysicist that's known for his ability to make complex scientific concepts more accessible to the general public? He has also weighed in on this simulation hypothesis. He gives it more of a 50-50 likelihood to the overall theory.
Like Mr. Musk thinks, are we living in simulation?
I find it hard to argue against that possibility.
Meaning,
you look at our computing power today and you say, I have the power to program a world inside of a computer. Well, imagine in the future where you have even more power than that, and you can create characters that have, for example, free will or their own perception of free will. So this is a world, and I program in the laws that govern that world. That world will have its own laws of physics and chemistry and biology. Now you're a character in that world and you think you have free will, and you say, I want to invent a computer, so you do. Hey, I want to create a world in my computer. And then that world creates a world in its computer. And then you have simulations all the way down.
Philosopher Nick Bostrom formalized this ancient quandary into the simulation argument. It's proposing a scenario that underscores the likelihood of humanity existing within a computer-generated simulation. So Bostrom's work bridges ancient philosophical concerns with contemporary scientific discourse. He's suggesting that advanced civilizations might actually simulate their ancestral lives, and therefore is going to make us question the authenticity of reality. A pivotal aspect of this theory revolves around consciousness, specifically whether it could emerge within a computer simulation. This inquiry delves into the mind-body problem, exploring the relationship between consciousness and physicality. If consciousness can be simulated to a degree that's indistinguishable from natural consciousness, the distinctions between simulated and base reality really start to blur, challenging everything we know and understand about everything. The nature of reality itself becomes a puzzle. What makes something real? If a simulated world is as complex and detailed as our own, where we can feel pain, joy, the warmth of the sun on our faces, wouldn't that simulation be just as real to us as the world we live in now? One of the key reasons we even think about living in a simulation is because of how quickly our technology is growing. Let's take a quick trip back in time to the early days of video games. Remember the old video games from the 70s or 80s? They were simple, blocky graphics that looked nothing like real life.
That's depressing. At least the music was good. Rock and roll. Really? Put another dime in the jukebox, baby.
But jump to today, and we've got virtual reality games that can make you feel like you're really inside the game. The jump from those simple games to the super realistic VR of today happened really fast, showing us how quickly technology can actually change. VR has gone from big, awkward helmets showing simple shapes to pretty sleek goggles that drop us into worlds so detailed that they actually can trick our brains into thinking they're real. This huge leap in tech makes some people wonder, if we keep improving our technology, could we make a simulation that's just like real life? But it's not just VR that's important. Artificial intelligence is already starting to create worlds on its own, learning and evolving in ways that were unimaginable not even that long ago. In quantum computing, it's going to revolutionize everything by processing data at speeds that we can barely comprehend, making the creation of even more complex and detailed simulations a real possibility in the near future. So what does all this mean for the simulation theory? Well, as our technology continues to advance at this unbelievable pace, the line between what's real and what's simulated gets blurrier and blurrier. If technology keeps getting better, could a super smart civilization, maybe even people from the future, create a world like ours as a simulation? If we're getting closer to being able to build worlds that are indistinguishable from reality, who's to say we aren't already living in one? But with all technology, nothing is ever perfect. Have you ever stumbled upon something that was so bizarre, so confusing, it made you pause and wonder, did that really just happen? Whether it's a person seemingly vanishing before your eyes or an object defying gravity, these odd occurrences are often dubbed as glitches in the matrix. Some people believe these glitches are errors in a vast computer program that we're living in, and it's offering fleeting glimpses into the possibility that our world might not be as solid or unchangeable as it seems. A prime example of these glitches is known as the Mandela effect. It's when a large group of people remembers an event differently from how it actually happened. A well-known instance is the memory of Nelson Mandela, which is where the name comes from. Everyone remembers him dying in the 1980s while he was still in prison, but he actually passed away in 2013, long after he was released. This collective misremembering raises questions like, could these be slips in the simulation's programming, or perhaps evidence of alternate realities or timelines intersecting with our own? More examples are Star Wars, the Luke, I am your father. Apparently, he never said that.
Yes, he did.
Nope. What about Febreze? I could have sworn that Febreze had two E's. Apparently, it only has one. And Pikachu's tail? Not having a black tip? I thought it had a black tip. Fruit of the Loom having a cornucopia in their logo.
A what?
Cornucopia, that's what it's called.
Looks like a basket.
The list goes on. If there's any specific ones that bother you, I'd really love to hear them in the comment section. But beyond the Mandela effect, there are countless other phenomena that challenge our understanding of reality. Have you ever noticed how certain numbers seem to follow you throughout the day? Or have you ever experienced a strong sense of deja vu, feeling like you're reliving a moment that you've never actually lived before? These experiences, from repeating numbers to intense feelings of familiarity with new places, it puzzles many and fuels speculation about the nature of our existence. You can go on online forums and social media, and there's endless supplies of examples of different types of glitches. But even the realms of physics presents phenomena that seemingly break the rules. Consider quantum entanglement, where particles become interconnected in such a way that the state of one, no matter how far it is, instantly influences the state of another. This instantaneous communication across vast distances challenges our conventional understanding of cause and effect. And also, the double slit experiment reveals particles changing behavior as if they're aware they're being observed.
I told you that in confidence. It was one time and I was in college. How did I know they...
Not that experiment.
Oh.
Yeah. Like I was saying, the double slit experiment reveals particles changing behavior as if they're aware they're being observed, hinting at a reality that adjusts based on observation. These scientific anomalies are sometimes pointed to as potential glitches, suggesting that the very fabric of our universe might be more of a simulation. So let's say that there are simulations and everything we're experiencing is in fact signs of there being simulations. The next question is, are we in one? The argument from probability plays a big role in the simulation theory. Here's the idea. If it's possible to create a simulation of the universe that's indistinguishable from the real thing, then advanced civilizations in the future might run many of these simulations just to study their history or explore theoretical scenarios. Given the vast number of possible simulations, the argument suggests it's more likely that we're living in one of these countless simulations rather than the original one. Think of it this way. If you have one real universe and potentially thousands or even millions of simulated universes, the odds of us being in the one real universe is pretty slim. It's like entering a game where you have one real golden ticket and millions of fake ones. Chances are, the ticket you pick up is probably going to be one of the fake ones.
Sorry, thinking about the double slit experiment.
But what does all this mean for us from an ethical point of view? It creates big questions that challenge our understanding of right and wrong, and what it truly means to be us. These questions aren't just tricky, they touch the very core of our existence and the universe. Tackling the simulation theory isn't just about wrapping our heads around the idea that reality might not be what it seems. It also pushes us to confront some pretty big ethical questions and philosophical head scratchers. But let's break it down into bite-sized pieces. Let's talk about creating our own simulated worlds. Imagine you've got the power to whip up a digital universe in your basement. Sounds like something out of the Matrix or Inception, right? Here's where it gets tricky. What if the characters in your simulation feel just as real as you and me? They laugh, they cry, they dream, maybe even fall in love. But since it's all happening in your computer, does that make their feelings any less real? This is where we stumble into a moral maze. Is it right for us to play God? Creating and controlling digital lives that feel just as rich and complex as our own?
Yes, it is.
Now let's shift gears and think about what this all means for the idea of being ourselves. You know how in Toy Story, the toys come to life and have their own thoughts and emotions? Well, if we're all just characters in some grand cosmic video games, what does that say about our own consciousness? Are we truly the masters of our fate, or are we just following a script written by some unseen programmer? This brings us to the classic dilemma. If every choice we make is part of a predetermined program, then what happens to free will? Philosophers have been wrestling these questions for ages. Think of it like the dilemma faced by Neo in The Matrix. Take the red pill and dive deeper into the reality of the simulation, or take the blue pill and continue living life as you know it, blissfully unaware of the strings being pulled behind the scenes. Exploring these challenges forces us to really re-examine what it means to be human, to make choices, and to live a meaningful life. Whether we're navigating the digital landscapes of VR, interacting with AI that seems eerily human, or pondering the nature of our own consciousness, the simulation theory invites us to question the very fabric of our existence and consider how we define reality itself. Accepting the possibility of a simulation doesn't necessarily mean giving up on reality.
Already have.
Instead, it invites us to look deeper into our existence and ask meaningful questions about life, love, and purpose. Whether or not we're in a simulation, the way we choose to live, how we treat others, the goals we pursue, and the beliefs we hold remains within our control. These choices define our reality, shaping the world we experience every day. The idea that we might be living in a simulation is interesting because it's hard to prove that it's not true. Think of the Big Bang as the moment that someone started the simulation. We haven't seen any aliens because maybe they're not included in the simulation. And UFOs? They might do things that don't fit with what we know about physics because they're special parts of the simulation, programmed by whoever made it.
But then, who made this big, complex simulation?
That's a good question. It's actually a really big question. Almost like asking if God's real. When amazing or scary things happen, it's as easy to say it's all part of the simulation as it is to say it's part of God's plan. It's interesting to see that many people who like the idea of a simulation don't believe in God. They think believing in God is like believing in fairy tales. On the other hand, some people who are very religious don't believe in things that scientists have discovered, like how animals change over time or how old the earth is. They say if there's no God and everything is just a simulation, then nothing really matters. Without God, our choices don't mean anything. But I don't think that's true. Even if this is all a simulation, what we do still affects us and others around us. And what happens after we die, whether we're in a simulation or not, who knows? Some people think you can't believe in both God and science. But isn't it kind of strange to argue about that? If believing in God and believing in simulation are kind of similar, then why argue about it? Both ideas are trying to explain the big questions we all have. So don't ever let someone else dictate your beliefs.
Guys, if you like these videos and you'd like to see more, please make sure to like, comment, subscribe, share, all that good stuff. It really helps the channel more than you can know, and I really would appreciate it because I would love to keep doing these videos. And Karen would also appreciate it.
My name is not Karen. Stop calling me that.
You're a Karen.
No, I'm not.
You're a Karen.
You know what?
Please make sure to share with your friends, like, comment, subscribe, share. You know it. It helps. Thanks.
Do it or else. And you know what? I actually wasn't done talking.